Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Valkyries Loom, The Archaeology of Cloth Production and Female Power in the North Atlantic, by Michèle Hayeur Smith. Narrated by Ann Richardson. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The Valkyries Loom into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then under the Supplemental Content section, please enter the access code WEAVE, that's W-E-A-V-E, and then click the Unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Introduction. She soon fell asleep, and she had a dream which she related to Peltnir on waking. "I dreamed," she said, "that I was staying here on this estate, and I thought that I had a gray-colored cloth in the loom. It seemed as though the weights were attached to the cloth, and I was weaving. When one of the weights fell down behind from the middle of the cloth, I noticed that the weights were the heads of men. I took up that head and recognized it." When Peltnir asked whose head it was, she said that it was King Harald Gormson's. Jomsviking Saga. The Valkyries Loom is a book about textiles, specifically textiles from the Scandinavian settlements of the North Atlantic. It is not a descriptive or technological book in nature. Rather, it addresses the social archaeology of textiles and textiles as a form of material culture that encodes information about the societies who made them. Textiles are like text, which is where the term comes from, and tell a story about hardships and successes, and most importantly, about the lives of the women who made them. The Valkyries Loom is the product of 9 years' analysis of textiles from the Viking and Norse colonies of the North Atlantic, incorporating the results of 3 National Science Foundation grants from Arctic Social Sciences, Imagining an Engendered Archaeology of the North Atlantic, Rags to Riches, an Archaeological Study of Textiles and Gender in Iceland, AD 874 to 1800, 2010 to 2013, and Weaving Islands of Cloth, Gender, Textiles, and Trade Across the North Atlantic from the Viking Age to the Early Modern Period, 2013 to 2016. In 2017, I was awarded a 1-year supplement to the 3rd grant, which enabled me to complete research on the Norse-Greenlandic assemblage. Archaeological textiles and their social use as a symbol of women's culture have never been addressed in the North Atlantic specifically. Most studies have focused on highly technical overviews of archaeological textiles, including thread counts, weave types, production techniques, tools, fleece type, or were in-depth ethnographic and descriptive analyses examining the finer textiles produced for ecclesiastic centers and religious use. The great majority of these studies in Iceland were performed by the late Elsie Guðjónsson, a pioneer of Icelandic textile work, but she left to her successors the huge task of tackling a corpus of unexamined archaeological textiles stored in the National Museum's warehouses. Guðjónsson's work was valuable and comprehensive, but discussed only a handful of these archaeological remains in Icelandic journals. The Faroe Islands had a similar devotee to the study of textiles, Nikolina Jense Bender, whom I had the pleasure of meeting in 2015, and who sadly passed away a year later. Bender published the volume Seyður Ulltøting, documenting all manner of textile work and production, from the origins of the Faroese sheep to spinning, weaving, and dyeing, and to documenting the extensive knitting traditions that developed in the Faroes. Neither of these women were archaeologists, but both devoted their lives to wool and its various uses in the recent past. Both also laid down the path for others, who would pick up where they left off. In Greenland, the most valuable contribution to the study of archaeological textiles came from the Danish National Museum's Else Østergaard, who in 2004 published Woven into the Earth, the most complete catalog and technical overview of archaeological textiles from Norse Greenland. Her work served as the foundation on which I built my own research. Additional work on archaeological material was performed by Penelope Walton Rogers, who analyzed Greenlandic textiles from the sites of the farm beneath the sand, Gården under sandet, GUS, Greenland, and the farm at Reykholt in Iceland. Walton Rogers also analyzed Inuit material from the eastern Canadian Arctic and elements from the Faroese collections, though these findings from the Faroes have not been published. Scottish Viking textiles were compiled and analyzed primarily by Lisa Bender Jorgensen and published in 1992, followed by Tia Gabra Sanders, who also passed away, leaving unfinished work. I used some of Gabra Sanders' analyses when recording and consulting the Viking Scottish material, which is largely stored at the National Museum of Scotland, with some collections scattered in regional museums, as well as the British Museum. All of these studies, while essential to the analysis of textiles, have never engaged the material culture as a way to seek an understanding of the social dynamics operating within each of these societies through cloth. What I hope to have achieved here is a social archaeology of textiles. Østergaard did present valuable social insights concerning the emergence of weft-dominant cloth and possible reasons for its proliferation in the Greenland Norse colony. But the work of delving into the deeper motivating factors behind textile work, its symbolic meaning, and what textile work actually meant to the women performing it, has been neglected. I felt that textiles and textile work were a medium as informative as any in understanding important social issues that characterized these North Atlantic Norse societies. Environmental stress, economy and trade, and even resistance to Danish colonial oversight. Therefore, after many trips back and forth across the North Atlantic for almost a decade to various museums where I counted threads and otherwise recorded these textiles in minute detail, I can say that this study of the North Atlantic material is by far the most extensive. An archaeology of gender in the North Atlantic. In recent decades, archaeological research in the North Atlantic has made remarkable advances, not only in synthetic analyses, but also in reporting basic data from excavations, surveys, and technical analyses. Work linking natural historical sequences with human activity and social histories provides multifaceted perspectives on social and environmental change, especially in Iceland, the largest of the Norse North Atlantic colonies. Archaeological research on Norse expansion into Greenland and the Faroe Islands has also received more attention in recent years, providing new insights into medieval transatlantic island colonization. Such works have addressed and continue to address issues of environmental change, human adaptation, sustainability, and human ecodynamics. Relatively less work has been carried out on the social aspects of material culture or economy not directly tied to subsistence or bioarchaeological analyses. The study of gender has particularly lagged in the North Atlantic and continues to do so, despite useful pioneering historical studies on women's roles in the Viking Age in Scandinavia or in mythology, and more recent work carried out on the roles of women during the Viking Age as warriors and as skalds, yet medieval and post-medieval documentary sources imply that women, particularly those involved in the production of cloth, played crucial roles in the economies of the Norse North Atlantic. Thus, women's work was not simply housework. Through their engagement and oversight of textile production, women controlled or had a direct hand in organizing one of the most crucial aspects of the North Atlantic economy. Gender theorists have actively challenged gender stereotypes that relegated women to the role of caregivers and denied, through either commission or omission, their involvement in power relationships and leadership roles. Many pioneering efforts have focused on finding women in the past, and more importantly still, on understanding relationships between men and women, and how those relationships played out in daily social discourse and changed through time. Women's roles in North Atlantic societies from the Viking Age to the post-medieval period have been the subjects of several seminal monographs, popular books, and articles that have shaped perceptions about women's roles in these periods. However, these studies, with exceptions, have focused on textual sources, institutional considerations, divorce, marriage, political and legal rights, etc., and representations of women in literary and visual arts without considering material culture in any depth. Investigations of the Saga literature tend to portray a view of strong Viking Age women able to take matters into their own hands and direct the affairs of men through the context of household politics, or, alternatively, using more subversive methods, such as magic, to gain power and autonomy in a largely patriarchal society and world dominated by social structures, male violence, and the legal system, to which women had no formal access. This vision of strong Viking Age and medieval women became a foundation through the 19th century and on into the 21st century for many studies of women's roles in later Icelandic society. Yet, as Auður Magnúsdóttir writes, the myth of the strong Viking woman, as she is illustrated in the Icelandic sagas, has not been challenged with any intensity, in spite of the critical examination of the sagas in general. She notes that the sagas were written by powerful 13th century men, who also wrote sagas about their own times, in which women were portrayed in these texts with far less active roles. She argues that the actions these sagas' authors attributed to Viking Age women led more often to disaster than success, while the more muted portrayal of 13th century women invests them with less ambiguity. Together, these differing visions of Viking Age and 13th century Norse women, produced by the same authors, raise difficult questions about whether the accepted vision of strong women in the Viking Age is accurate or apocryphal, factual or fictive. However, historical research on women's contributions to the North Atlantic economy, especially textile production, suggests that women gained stronger roles in household and regional economic structures after the Viking Age, in the medieval period, and this has been confirmed by ongoing research on textiles. Some of these more powerful roles appear to have the very nature of textile work, deeply held associations with concepts of life, death, birth, and fate, and men's seeming anxiety over this highly gendered activity. Yet the continued focus on men and men's roles in the later medieval and post-medieval sources, whether law codes or literary works, and in much secondary scholarship, leaves many questions about whether women's changing roles in economic activities merely increased their workloads or enhanced their positions. At the very least, the documentary-based vision of medieval women in the North Atlantic cannot be considered unproblematic, making archaeological perspectives essential in understanding women of the North Atlantic past. A second strand of research on women in the North that relies almost exclusively on archaeological data has been spun from studies of mortuary sites and their representations of women in death. Many of these analyses, undertaken in mainland Scandinavia, may be only partially applicable to the North Atlantic setting. In 2003 and 2004, for example, I showed that the North Atlantic mortuary program for women's graves had its own logic, different from Viking-age mortuary traditions in mainland Scandinavia. These differences may perhaps be consonant with studies of mitochondrial DNA, showing that Iceland's female population was drawn heavily from the British Isles, although the male population was drawn from Scandinavian gene pools. Yet, while Gestsdottir and Maher have reviewed the mortuary corpus, drawing attention to the need for separating biological sex from gender in mortuary analyses, we do not know who made the decisions about how the dead were to be buried, and whether the representation of women in death reflects their own wishes, those of their kinsmen, or some combination of those. The mortuary record, like the literary record, is not unproblematic, and across the North Atlantic it becomes nearly silent after AD 1000, when these societies adopted Christianity and corpses went to their graves unadorned. Recent work at early Christian cemeteries, such as the 11th century graveyard at Keldudalur in northern Iceland and Greenland's Herjolfsnes cemetery, shows that men and women were buried in different parts of these cemeteries, suggesting that gender, more than marital status, age, or kinship relations, define the place of women in death, and perhaps in life. These important studies provide key insights into the ways women were viewed by others in literary and legal documents, or in death. But few projects have focused directly on women's lives and women's living contributions to North Atlantic Norse society without the intermediacy of the book or the graveside ritual. Doing so requires approaching women archaeologically by what they did and what they made. Excavations at summer farms, sel, sheelings, inhabited by women engaged in dairying, provide an interesting approach to understanding engendered space. Still in their early stages, these investigations promise to provide new insights into women's contributions to the subsistence economy. And recently, the Woman in Blue project, of which I was a curatorial advisor and a main researcher, and which is touched upon briefly in Chapter 2, used a multidisciplinary approach integrating artifact analyses, bioarchaeological analyses, isotopic analyses, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, strontium, ADNA, and accelerated mass spectrometry, AMS, dating to develop an integrated approach to understanding the life history, identity, and death of an early female settler in Iceland, with an exhibition at the National Museum of Iceland presenting these interdisciplinary approaches to the public. However, another avenue to finding women, the focus of my research, is to assess changes through time and variation across space in one of the industries women controlled, textiles. Globally, textiles have been produced by both men and women, yet textile production and the manufacture of clothing were overwhelmingly women's work in traditional European societies. Medieval Icelandic and Danish colonial sources document that textile production in Iceland was in the hands of women, even though the total process, from raising sheep to trading cloth or making clothing, was served by an engendered division of labor. Across the North Atlantic until the mid-18th century, the tasks of cleaning and combing wool, spinning, weaving, and producing clothes were women's work. In Viking Age burials, North Atlantic women were frequently interred with weaving and spinning implements. They also embroidered woolen textiles, knitted by a single needle method, Njál binding, and during the 16th century began knitting with two needles. Through the course of nine centuries, AD 870 to 1800, Icelandic women produced these textiles in their households, without specialized craftsmen or factories. In Greenland, the Faroes, Norse Scotland, and rural Norway, the situation was similar. Weaving and textile production were female activities undertaken on farms. From the mid-18th century onward, however, these gendered relations of production changed. Under Danish and British colonial policies to modernize North Atlantic societies, men were trained to produce textiles in factories using new technologies. Understanding the changing roles of women in North Atlantic societies is, therefore, in part a study of the different roles of cloth within these North Atlantic islands and the interrelationships these roles suggest about the local and transregional importance of domestic production. Therefore, I have argued that by looking at textile production as women's labor, at the material culture of textile production, and at the processes of women's production as rich bodies of evidence for women's active decision-making, we can begin to identify these women and the roles they played in shaping the societies of the North Atlantic. In addition to decision-making and the production of women's labor, cloth was about female expression. In a society where women were not equal to men and were not given equal voice, textiles provided a way for women to express themselves in terms of their opinions and solutions, vis-à-vis the challenges that faced them. Norse society valued male verbal expression, the cultivation of poetic skills and verbal prowess. But how did women commune in such an environment? As Norman argued, the weaving of cloth and the embroidery of wall hangings and tapestries were visual mechanisms that women in Norse society used to express their messages. Burlow drew a similar parallel in Latin America, where women demonstrate a visual fluency and cultural knowledge in the molas they weave, constituting an alternate form of discourse. There, too, male expression has largely been focused on verbal skill. Textiles are loaded with social messages. They assert personal identities, as well as religious, economic, and cultural ones. For anthropologists and those interested in the cultural ramifications of cloth, textiles are eloquent historical texts, encoding change, appropriation, oppression, and endurance, as well as personal and cultural aesthetic visions. The collections and the nature of North Atlantic Norse societies. The textile collections from the North Atlantic are surprisingly rich, given that the archaeological textiles do not usually, as organic remains, survive the effects of time. A few other areas globally offer a wealth of these precious organic remains, and in the North Atlantic, the unique environmental conditions and the way textiles were deposited have all contributed to their preservation, largely in the middens of Norse farms. The Greenlandic archaeological textile collection includes roughly 866 to 1,000 fragments, while the Faroese material, a much smaller collection, comprises 142 fragments. The Icelandic corpus, on the other hand, which sparked my interest in textiles and laid the groundwork for all subsequent studies, possesses approximately 8,000 to 10,000 fragments and is still increasing. I also incorporated elements from the Scottish corpus, when appropriate, but found that apart from Viking Age material of the northern Scottish Isles, it became unclear in subsequent centuries what derived from Norse versus local Scottish textile traditions. The Scottish collections from the later Middle Ages can hardly be described as Norse, since the Norse were less numerous than the local inhabitants of the British Isles and quickly assimilated, leaving few distinguishing cultural traits that could be identified in the textile corpus. As a result, the coverage of these collections in this book is minor. What broad conclusions can be derived from a collection of 142 fragments? The numbers of textiles in these collections are not final, because research is ongoing and new material comes to light yearly. In some instances, it was never my intention to do a complete sweep of a collection because analyzing 8,000 fragments of a 10,000-fragment corpus doesn't advance their interpretation, particularly from a sociocultural perspective. Moreover, funds are not infinite, and my goal was not to provide textile catalogs, but rather to synthesize and establish the overall trends of these textile traditions, and to extract key social elements that fueled or curtailed production. The islands of the North Atlantic serve as a unique laboratory setting because none of these places had local populations, excepting Scotland, before their Norse settlement. Iceland was, apart from a handful of pauper or Irish monks, most of whom fled with the arrival of the Norse, settled in A.D. circa 874. Greenland was settled later in A.D. circa 985, by a group of people fleeing western Iceland, where Erik the Red, their leader, had been outlawed. Some indigenous inhabitants had been present in Greenland but did not enter the Norse-occupied southern areas, known as the eastern and western settlements, until the 14th century, when climatic cooling from the Little Ice Age pushed the migrating Thule peoples into Norse settlement areas. The Faroe Islands were settled in A.D. circa 800, but there, as in Iceland, no local inhabitants were present. The remoteness and isolation of these North Atlantic societies from Western Europe provide a unique opportunity to observe, archaeologically, their evolution, far from their country of origin, each one dealing with its own social and environmental dynamics and evolving into completely different models of Norse culture. The settlers were largely from Scandinavia, but in each of these islands, people from the British Isles and Ireland were brought over as slaves and concubines, creating societies that differed from the Scandinavian societies of the Viking Age. Time frame, scope, and material. The period under investigation is a long one, from the late 9th century to the beginning of the 19th century, because only over long periods of time can the changes in material culture really be documented. Textiles in traditional cultures rarely change and remain surprisingly conservative over centuries. When changes do occur, in spin direction, weave type, or thread counts, these can signal important social, environmental, or cultural changes and manifestations taking place within societies. In Iceland, looking at textile traditions over a 900-year period has permitted me to track physical changes in cloth, a chronology of weaving that could be used as a relative dating method in conjunction with other absolute dating methods, as discussed in Chapter 2. In Norse Greenland, Chapters 4 and 5, the comparison of cloth from the early settlement to cloth from the end of the settlement facilitated the study of weft-dominant cloth, as cloth from the early settlement closely resembles that of Iceland. Analyzing thread counts in medieval Icelandic cloth suggests, in Chapter 3, that the use of cloth as currency did not end in the 13th century, but that its standardization as a monetary entity in Iceland continued until the early 17th century. This book largely focuses on homespun cloth, the everyday cloth used by the masses, not on the elaborate fine textiles of the elite, though in these regions the elite wore clothes similar to those of everyone else, perhaps with minor additions of imported cloth. Chapters 6 and 7. This cloth was homespun, functional, and warm, and was made from the wool from a group of breeds called the European Varicolored Shorttail, or the Northern Shorttail sheep, with its unique characteristic of two different fiber types incorporated into its fleece. The tog was the outer coat, with long, coarse outer guard hairs recognizable by the presence of a medulla, and the thel was a fine, fluffy undercoat without medullas, and soft as merino wool. in the early settlement of these islands, as well as in Viking Age Scandinavia, the wool was combed and the coarse outer guard hairs were separated and used as warp yarns because they were strong, whereas the soft and fluffy inner coat was used as weft and felted naturally, making a type of cloth that was both semi-waterproof and warm. Eventually, the Icelanders stopped combing the wool to produce a product known to this day as lopi, incorporating both fibers. All across the North Atlantic islands, the main cloth types were largely twills, 2-to-2, 2-to-1, and patterned twills and tabbies, plain weaves, woven with Z-to-S spun yarns. Other weaves are also present, depending on the period. Some shaggy pile-woven cloth, known as varafelter in modern Icelandic, has been recorded, though in minimal quantities. Knitting occurs late in the sequence, around the 16th century, and new textile technologies only make their appearance across the North Atlantic in the 18th century, as the result of Danish colonial rule. The device these women used for 1,000 years was the warp-weighted loom, a Neolithic invention said to have been introduced to Scandinavia in the 3rd century. This simple upright loom was portable, easy to set up, and relatively straightforward to operate. Weaving often took place in a separate structure called a dingja, a small pit house usually located outside the main hall. It was only in the Middle Ages, after Christianization, that the dingja was abolished, and weaving was moved into the central skauli, or longhouse. It was possible to weave cloths of great widths, up to 1,880 millimeters, on the warp-weighted loom, based on finds from the West Greenlandic site of GUS. Because of the loom's upright position, loom weights, often just perforated stones, were suspended from the warp yarns, creating tension. Heddle rods placed horizontally could be added to create more complex weaves by moving certain warp yarns forward or backward for yarns that were knitted to the heddle rods. Yarns were initially spun using the drop spindle in the Viking Age, which was replaced over time by the high-top whorl, whereby the spindle is set in motion by rolling it up or down one's leg. The drop spindle was often used with a distaff. Spindle whorls are common on Norse farms across the North Atlantic, mostly made of soapstone and of different diameters depending on the desired thickness of yarn. But this study involves more than homespun. It also includes cloth imports in the medieval and early modern periods in the North Atlantic. This aspect of the research provided insights into trade and the export and import of woolen goods into and from the North Atlantic. The chapters are arranged according to region and follow a temporal sequence, beginning with the Viking Age and progressing through the early medieval, late medieval, and early modern periods. Throughout these chapters, I have attempted to bring women's lives into the discussion, to bring them to the forefront, as symbolized by the Valkyries, an embodiment of female mythical power, interweaving important themes, the ideological frameworks within Scandinavian societies that linked women's work on textiles to mythic themes involving the Valkyries and other female deities and spirits, to the prominence of vaðmál, the cloth that became currency in Iceland and a trade commodity across the North Atlantic, and the roles men played in transforming the textiles women wove into products of trade. 1. Cold are the counsels of women. Bloodied warps and gilded wefts. The engendered economy of cloth in the North Atlantic. Blood rains from the cloudy web on the broad loom of slaughter. The web of man, gray as armor, is now being woven. The Valkyries will cross it with a crimson weft. The warp is made of human entrails. Human heads are used as weights. The heddle rods are blood-wet spears. The shafts are iron-bound, and arrows are the shuttles. With swords we will weave this web of battle. Darraðarljoð, Njál Saga. The poem Darraðarljoð provides a good starting point to discuss weaving in Norse society and perceptions held about textile work during the Viking Age in the North Atlantic and Scandinavia. Textiles and textile work appear to have generated considerable trepidation on the part of men in this society. This chapter will explore these issues in Iceland, delving into the archaeological record and the sagas, documents written from the late 12th through mid-14th centuries, but recounting events and attitudes from several centuries earlier, during Iceland's so-called settlement period, AD 870 to 1000. While they are not taken as accurate narratives of events from the Viking Age, they do present ethnographic information that is of value when analyzing cultural attitudes in the North Atlantic. The settlement of the North Atlantic. Iceland was settled in AD 874 by Scandinavian settlers, Vikings, best known for their marauding behavior, including pillaging, trading, and ultimately colonization across the Western world. Iceland was discovered as Greenland was, accidentally, by storm-tossed sailors, though Iceland can boast of having three discoverers, the best known of them, Floki Vilgerðarson, also called Hrafna-Floki, Raven-Floki, for his use of ravens in seeking land. He named the country Iceland because during his first winter his livestock perished, and when he climbed a mountain to oversee his prospects for settlement, what stretched before him were the frozen landscapes of Árnafjörður. He returned to Norway disenchanted with the place, and only a decade later, in AD 874, according to Ari the Wise, Iceland's earliest historian, Iceland's founding father, Ingólfur Árnason, sailed back to establish a permanent settlement. Scandinavian Vikings had settled the Faroe Islands a few decades earlier, whereas Greenland was settled from Iceland more than a century later by the outlaw Erik the Red, who had been banned from Norway for manslaughter and from Iceland for 3 years for the same reason, prompting him to sail westward looking for greener pastures. Following the route of an earlier sailor, Gudbjörn Ulfsson, Erik reached the southwestern coast of Greenland in AD 982 and encountered uninhabited rich farmland, not unlike what he had left behind in western Iceland. He returned to Iceland in 986 after his 3 years of outlawry and gathered 25 ships of settlers to sail back to Greenland. Of these 25 ships, only 14 arrived safely. They settled in what came to be known as the Eastern Settlement, with a population of 1,120 to 4,800, 12 parish churches, and a cathedral at Garðar, now called Igaliku. Iceland's population at the time of the settlement, also called the Landnám period, the taking of land, was considerably larger, numbering between 40,000 and 70,000. Certain parts of the British Isles were occupied by Norse settlers even earlier than the Faroe Islands, Iceland, or Greenland, circa AD 800. Ireland is considered the first area in the North Atlantic to have been colonized by the Norse, who founded the town of Dublin and exercised considerable control and power over local inhabitants. Other Norse settlement areas in the British Isles included Orkney, Shetland, Caithness, the Hebrides, the Isle of Man, and much of northern England, from the Midlands to the Scottish Marches, where the city of York became their regional center. From these areas, Norse settlers gleaned information on the North Atlantic Isles farther west. These Vikings who settled across the North Atlantic were not a cohesive invading army, nor were they culturally unified. They brought with them cultural practices and beliefs from Norway and the rest of mainland Scandinavia. Although their dominant cultural traditions were Scandinavian, from the ways they organized their economy to their animal husbandry practices and the legal systems that they established in their new colonies, many of these Scandinavians appear to have come from families who had already settled in the British Isles, where they had set down roots, married local women, and had many Irish or Hebridean slaves. Through the contacts these families had made and through the diverse traditions shared by their members, other cultural influences made their way to the more westerly North Atlantic settlements. Mitochondrial DNA studies on modern Icelanders, undertaken by Helgason and others, as well as other researchers, have demonstrated a significant Celtic component among Iceland's female settlers. These different cultural influences are also visible in textiles and textile production in the western North Atlantic settlements. Two approaches to textile work, Norwegian and insular, can be distinguished and are reviewed in detail in Chapter 2. Women, Cloth, and Sagas, Text and Archaeology. The overall political and economic spheres of these North Atlantic Norse societies were dominated by men, yet textile production was a very gendered occupation, controlled by women, that intersected with all aspects of political, economic, and domestic life, and gave rise to beliefs that connected textiles with women's lives, activities, and beliefs. Textiles wove their way into all aspects of human existence, from birth to death, and, more importantly, in the determination of fate. Cloth and its production became symbolically gendered and associated with a woman's world and with female power. Schneider and Weiner's characterization of associations between women and cloth rings true for the North Atlantic. Women not only make cloth, but also preside over its allocation at major rituals of death and regeneration, marriage and the establishment of new families, investiture and the transmission of ancestral authority. Textiles had such varied utilitarian purposes as clothing, household accessories, sails for ships, and tents. Their social roles changed over an 800-year period from being products of local household domestic weaving, frequently deposited in burial contexts, to elements of central importance within Iceland's economic system during the Middle Ages. Textiles were used as currency in a commodity money system, legally regulated in medieval law codes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.